The time is 6:30, and we'll call the regular Board of Education meeting to order and have roll call, please.
Dyke.
Present.
Walker.
Here.
Frisbee.
Present.
Macomber.
Here.
Wintering.
Here.
All members present and accounted for. Agenda item one is the approval of the agenda. Are there any changes or corrections, Dr. Cox?
No changes.
Is there a motion?
I'll make a motion to approve the agenda as presented.
Been moved and seconded to approve the agenda as published. Roll call vote, please.
Wintering.
Yes.
Walker.
Yes.
Frisbee.
Yes.
Macomber.
Yes.
Dyke.
Yes. Motion carried 5-0. Agenda item two is to welcome the visitors and have public comment. As we begin our agenda tonight, I'll explain our process for public comment. The board will hear comments from the public in conjunction with each agenda item using a structured process. As board president, I will ask for comments when we reach that item on the agenda. You will be asked to approach the microphone, state your name, and limit your comments to 2 minutes. At this time, I invite any member of the audience to step up to the microphone with comments about items of interest or concern that do not appear on tonight's agenda. Please begin by stating your name and contact information. It would be appreciated if you would limit your comments to 2 minutes so that we can keep the meeting moving in a timely fashion and allow others an opportunity to speak, as well as allowing the board to complete the full board agenda in a timely manner. Comments from the public are limited to matters within the board's authority. Please understand that we as a board cannot discuss items not already on the agenda. Iowa's Sunshine Law prohibits us from having a discussion without the proper notice to all of the school district community that the issue would be discussed at tonight's board meeting. Also, please remember, you are making comments in a public meeting. Should you make comments that the subject of the comments considers to be inflammatory or libelous, you as an individual may be subject to legal action brought by the subject of your comments. Thank you for your support of our school district. Are there any comments by the public at this time?
There are, Mr. Chairman.
Doug Lindeman from Charles City. I'd just like to comment on an item from last week with regard to FEH. I think that was a wise choice to bring them in. I wish we'd only done it 3 or 4 years sooner. I think we need to keep in mind not to take a victory lap quite yet. With the evaluation of City Hall, Courthouse, Middle School, I think we need to keep in mind that we may find that the best alternative is not for the city to be involved, the Y to be involved, or for the county to be involved. There are going to be a substantial number of citizens asking that you continue it as a school and to basically take the building, your building, and make it your high school. So I think we have a lot of deciding to do in the next few months as to the final outcome as to the use of the middle school. But suffice it to say, from the community standpoint, as one member of the community, I don't think we, as city dwellers, the people in the country, or people of the Y, need to be correcting the problem with the middle school. So if we can keep it as a school, I think it will work out in the long run. FEH will need to evaluate that prospect in the near future. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments from the public? Hearing none, we'll move on to agenda item three, comments by board members and superintendent. We'll start off with Dr. Cox.
Thank you. Although students were done on May 22nd, teachers and administrators have been quite busy since that time. Today and tomorrow we have 12 teachers and 10 teachers and 2 administrators at the Iowa ASCD Summer Institute in Des Moines. We've got a 13-member teacher leadership committee that has been busy at work, meeting several times, including spending a day down in Van Horn at Benton Community High School last week. We've got another committee of 10 to 12 teachers and administrators working on revising the mission and vision statements. When you add in curriculum work, it's been a very busy June. As Doug referenced, there is a joint entity task force that's being created, the city, the county, the Y, and the school district. Invitations are going out this week for the advisory task force. All of the meetings will be open to the public, and the public is encouraged to attend and provide input throughout this whole process. And then finally, we are launching a new website on July 1st. So look for a new look to the website and hopefully much easier to navigate and find the information that you're seeking.
Very good. Any other comments from the board? Hearing none, we'll move on to agenda item four, which is the middle school addition plan specifications, form of contract, and estimated cost for the public hearing. We'll just verify with Board Secretary O'Brien that we did publish the public hearing in accordance with the law.
Yep.
Okay. So this would be the time and place fixed for the public hearing of the adoption of plan specifications, form of contract, and estimate of total cost for package two of the middle school project. Have we received any written comments, objections, positive or negative?
No.
No. Are there any oral comments, positive or negative?
Yes.
Doug Lindeman, Charles City. I'd basically renew the written objection I filed last time on specifics, but I think I'd also point out the long-term ramifications of entering into a contract at this time based on the financing you've proposed. And it's basically this. We're looking at every year spending $20 million. That's about your budget. You're looking at buying a building for $18.8 million, probably some overrun in there, gets it close to $20 million probably. So to the people in this room, I'd ask this question. If you were earning $80,000 or $100,000, and at the end of the day, I'm gonna tag you with a debt equal to your basic income that you're living on, would that change your budget for the year? In other words, if you're making $100,000 and I tag you with $100,000 of debt, would it change how you're going to be spending your money in the future? And I think that's what the school is up against. That by entering into this contract, we're basically overspending our budget. Put another way, and in answer to Jim Frisbee's question from last week, if we're going to be making building improvements, for example, having to pour extra concrete at the bus barn or in other locations, in the future, are we going to have the money? Well, we've had $2.1 million coming in the way of sales tax revenue predominantly, Pebble money, and a little bit of surtax, as I recall. About $2.1 million. That's been coming in to be used on buildings and equipment. Now, in what I'm seeing that Jerry Mitchell is doing, I don't see him buying any gold-plated commodes. I don't see him having extra money, in other words. Now, we're going to take of that $2.1 million that's been coming in every year, and we've been tight, I think. We're going to use $1.4 million of it to pay off this building every year for the next 15 years, roughly. So that left you about $700,000. I don't believe the $700,000 is going to be enough money to run the system for equipment improvements, building improvements. When Jim asked the question last time, do we have enough money out in years 3 and 4 to pay for extra concrete, nobody had an answer. And I think the answer is, no, we don't. Schools traditionally shortchange their buildings for maintenance. And I think we're going to be shortchanging them more. Recently, over the past couple of years with Jerry Mitchell here, and using that $2.1 million, I think you've been doing a much better job. But I don't see us doing a much better job after we enter into this long-term contract and have to pay for it. No doubt you can borrow the money. It's the payment in the end that scares me. I think it scares most citizens. I think we've gone down the wrong trail on this. But we've started down it. But I think it's a trail that's going to end in financial disaster for us. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lindeman. Any other comments during the public hearing? This is a public hearing on the middle school phase two.
Oh, that's fine. Without public comments.
We've already passed that. Sorry. If there's no others on the public hearing, we will close the public hearing and move on to agenda item five, which is the public hearing deliberation by the board. This is a discussion item only. Any deliberation from the board or comments?
My response to the public comment would be that I would encourage our commenter to further investigate the cash flow projections that have been given by our Piper Jaffray. They've shown some very conservative figures in these projections for the payments of this debt. They have also shown built into that projection that our $750,000 annual PEPAL expenditure for Jerry's budget essentially has built in a 3% increase annually. So that budget is expected to increase annually, and that's built into the long-term repayment of the debt. So not only is it very fiscally conservatively estimated, it's a very appropriate use of the funding according to the state as written by the law. So I support it.
I would also add that in response to that comment, I've been reminded numerous times by numerous individuals in this community that the financing package of this project is one of the best, most conservative, vetted financial packages in years in this community. And I do get reminded of that by people practically every month to move forward with this project. So any other comments by board members? Hearing none, we will move on to item 6, the resolution adopting plans, specifications, form of contract, and estimated cost of the middle school addition project. This is where we would continue on and approve all of that that we have just had the public hearing and discussion on.
Motion to approve a resolution adopting plans, specification, form of contract, and estimated cost of the middle school addition project.
I'll second that.
It's been moved and seconded to approve agenda item 6 as presented. Any further discussion? Hearing none, we'll have roll call vote, please.
Walker?
Yes.
Frisbee?
Yes.
Maycumber?
Yes.
Wintering?
Yes.
Dyke?
Yes. Motion carried 5-0. Agenda item 7, middle school construction project. We have Jean Underwood here.
I have a short agenda tonight, fortunately. I went ahead and brought, we're gonna start with the environmental graphics for the learning studios. I have some additional images for you to look at. I think the last time I was here, I shared the images from the Explore classroom, and so I've got some additional images to show you of some of the other lab spaces. So if you remember, for the base bit of the project, above the entrance to each classroom will be a colored soffit, and on that would be the environmental graphic identifying what that space is for both wayfinding and to provide branding for that space. So for the Explore, it's a green soffit, and you can see applied over that in a darker tone of green would be different symbols and icons that represent Explore. If you look at the bottom at the elevation, you can see next to that is the cave, which is in blue. Next to that is the makespace in purple, the camp, design, and then cave again. So we'll look at, before we move on, alternate bid. If we are able to get the operable glass partitions, we still have the color soffit above, but we move those graphics down so that they are on the glass. All right, so that would be for all of those learning spaces except for the cave and the camp, which don't have glass walls, so those would stay up above. So here's a blow up of the cave space. You can see where it's a combination of words and images. In the make space, this is the kind of the flex lab that's between the other two labs. Talking about discovery, thinking, building, listening, creating, and then images that go along with that as well. The alternate. The camp space with images of kind of camping, campfire, exploring, those kinds of things. The design lab. The alternate bid. And then the second cave space. I was hoping to have the listen and the create or the media lab as well, but they weren't able to get those images to me in time to bring to the meeting, so I'll send those to you as well. Were there any questions on the environmental graphics in the studios?
When we had talked about these before, you had mentioned that they would just be basically peel and stick, and if we wanted to move things around, peel and stick. The side notes over here list it as a custom digital heavyweight wallpaper.
Yeah, what it is it's like a vinyl film that's adhesive.
So it's going over paint?
It is going over paint.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. It's not peel and stick in the sense that you can take it off and move it.
Right.
It's semi-permanent. It's not something, it's like if you put up wallpaper in your house, you can take it down, but it's not something that you're going to want to change out every year.
If we don't end up with our glazed doors, mm-hmm. panels, could you price this out separate for each, for just the whole, all the learning studios, what that graphic will run? As opposed to me putting together a crew and just painting it up there.
Oh, break out the cost of the environmental graphics?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I see that as an area that I could probably take care of without any problem. If we get the glazed doors, though, which I'm hoping for, we're back to those vinyl graphics.
Right. That's something that we can always deduct from the project.
Okay.
After everything goes out to bid, we'll bid it like it is. If everything comes in and get everything you want, great. If it looks like you need to do some cost reductions, that would be a great area to look at doing that.
I just wanted to make sure, because the description in here says it's applied to the gyms, and it's a wallpaper, and it's applied to the gyms and board. Just want to make sure there's paint underneath there. So the
right, so it's a clear film, okay. And then it has the darker green, so that when you layer it on top of the paint.
So it's basically a film.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah. Painted would be preferred. Impossible. I like the graphics. I think they're fine. The tone on tone is good.
All right, moving on to the gymnasium. Basically, this is the same floor layout that I presented the last time that it sounded like everybody liked the best. So that hasn't changed. Updating the interior images to include one of the gray colors along the bottom wall sections, but then also starting to put in some of your banners and scoreboards, those kinds of things. Now, the scoreboard that's shown right here is not the information that Todd just sent me last week. Like, what day is it? It's Monday. So the scoreboard that he sent me is a little bit bigger than that. It'll all still fit in there. But just to give you an idea of what that could look like. So this is the wall that leads into the commons area. So you would walk through these to go into the commons. This is the east elevation, so this, if you're looking at a set of plans, it's on the bottom of the page. So this is one option for the bleachers. You can see it's alternating between orange and a dark gray with CC in the center. So this is one option. You can see off to the far left and the far right, we have places for some more banners, for award banners, those kinds of things, as a potential location. All right, a second option for this, this is the same elevation. You can see more orange bleachers with letters on the front with kind of a shadow effect. This is a lot more orange in the space. And then on the far side, because we do have five sections of bleachers, doing a gray with the CC in either a light gray or a white. Another option to do CCH in the center in the letters with gray bleachers on either side.
Consensus is grab that last one you showed.
Okay.
I don't think we have any of them that are quite.
And if there's things you like about some of them or don't like, I know Lorraine sent me some information late last week as well. Just kind of some ideas that you guys had seen.
You know, maybe I'll let everybody else know what I sent to Jean, because I just sent it to Jean and Dr. Cox, and it was from Robin and myself. We went over to Waverly to take a look at their gym and see what the design of their bleachers were and what the colors were in combination with their floor, because we felt that maybe their black and gold would give us maybe a futuristic view of what our gym might look like. And they did not have the black surrounding their floor. They had their gold. So it's a little bit different. They didn't have a logo. I think after we had met, we really liked that logo the best, and we did like the black that we've chosen the best. Mm-hmm. So it really kind of confirmed to us that this is a good design. Though we also had been talking about maybe we should add the orange to the perimeter, didn't we? No.
No.
Never mind.
It doesn't show up very well on the maple flooring.
Yeah, no. We stuck with the black. Mm-hmm. But then when we looked at the bleachers and looked at our color chip for our orange, their gold is very close to our orange, our yellow-orange that we have. And so we could really get a good depiction of what that might look like with our gym. And their bleachers, where they had orange bleachers, were scuffed up quite a bit. So we were a little nervous about picking something that would get a lot of traffic and wear, and we want it to look nice, not for the next 20 years or so or beyond. The richness of their black bleachers was really attractive to us, and so, you know, we came away with their feeling like, well, black and gray with some orange maybe as the design, and the drop shadow like you have, you know, seemed like options that we would like to explore. Is there anything else you want to add, Robin?
Their gym was completed in 07, so that gives us a time frame too, that it was very many years, but we basically found a picture of their gym online, and it was very similar to what we're looking at. So we just took an opportunity to, since it was close, and the community is the same, same type of mm-hmm. farming community as what we have. So you know the footwear is going to be about the same as what we had. And
So after going and seeing it, I'm comfortable with what we're thinking. I like the gray bleachers that you've picked. I think if we could do a combination of gray and black,
Perhaps even something like this, Lorraine, where instead of the orange as the background, it's a gray as a background with the orange letters.
Yeah.
You know, and just a little bit.
Yeah.
A little bit of the orange. We can go back to the drawing board and send some more options.
Would make it pop.
Yeah, that's what we'd like to see. We'd like to see black and gray bleachers, just orange for the letters, and if we can start our letters 4 to 5 bleachers up, we have plenty of height. I did check with some bleacher companies, and to get a good letter shape, you need 8. We've got 14 is what our letters are. We've got quite a few, because we've got 2 stories.
Right.
So we probably can afford to come up that.
I was thinking that as well, because we talked about having 3 rows of bleachers out for when we're doing cross-court play, mm-hmm. to be able to still see the letters mm-hmm. behind where the spectators are.
And those are going to be really hard-use bleachers, so if we think of that whatever color, if we pick the charcoal or the black, those are going to be the hardest use bleachers, and so that if we can keep them away from that orange color.
That drop shadow, I think, gives you more dimension. I would say that the bleachers that we saw, the design seemed a little boxy and a little small, mm-hmm. and so, you know, I think this looks a whole lot better.
Other than we take it. The other conversation I would like to have here, what should they say? I don't know about this either. We're building a gym that's connected to the middle school. Yes, it is eventually gonna be the Charles City High School gym. Do we wanna identify it right out of the gate as that? Is there any way we task them with trying to fit comments in there? Anybody else have some input on what they would like to see there?
1, 2, 3.
I like the simple CC. Pretty simple.
It will be the high school gym.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
It will be.
But the simple CC
is. I like that probably out of all.
I like, because what do you do with the fifth panel if you have CC, H, and S?
Mm-hmm.
I don't like the CC off to the side with the CC, H, S. It's.
Yeah.
It just doesn't look right to me. Mm-hmm. But that is simple and.
I like it.
Nice.
Mm-hmm. So if you did black and gray, for the five. blocks and then the orange letters.
Well, and I even think you could do some of the orange up above. It was just where people would normally walk down. I think you get to the upper ones. People are not going to walk down them like they are on
down
the lower
low,
ones.
Right.
So even if you wanted to keep like a stripe of orange going through through those side ones, since there isn't going to be any lettering, I think that would be great to put some of that orange on either end.
Okay.
Can you do the shadow effect that Lorraine was talking about that you have on some of the other ones in that, or is there not enough seating?
Probably not on this one, but let me see if we can adjust the aisle spacing so that we have more seats in the
aisle.
Center, possibly. I'm not sure. I'll have to check the
go.
Code requirements, but if you give us kind of a direction like you are now, we can kind of play with it a little bit and see what we can come up with.
That'd be great if you could expand the center and just put our logo in the center with the drop shadow out of the orange, some orange accent on either end in the form of probably a stripe going vertically.
You didn't mean logo.
I'm sorry.
Go back a picture, please.
This
that
one?
Way or the other way?
The other way, I think. Where the heads.
Oh, this
yeah.
one. Let's see. I think that's the last one. So we've got, this is.
That's too much. That was simple.
I think we were showing the east and the west, and they're the same, so that's why they look like duplicates.
Mm-hmm.
All right, well, we'll do a little sketching and come up with a couple different options for you and bring those back.
Just do it that way.
Just do one correct option?
Just one correct
one. Okay. All right, let's see here. I didn't know if you wanted to talk about the food service stuff. I'd forwarded some drawings over. I can kind of walk through those serving areas. Okay. I don't have pretty pictures. These are working drawings. So I forwarded, it's like a 10-page document that shows all of the layouts for the different food service equipment for the three different locations. So the first one that we're seeing here is the existing high school kitchen. You can see, I don't have a pointer. In this space, we're removing the existing walk-in cooler and freezer and turning that into a dry storage. Ignore where that says office, that'll be storage. We're looking at reusing a lot of the existing middle school and high school kitchen storage shelves to help save some cost. We can talk about whether or not that will work out for future plans, but for now, that's what we're calling for. So taking existing and using that as much as possible, I did a survey the last time I was here of all that different equipment. So you can see the main part of the kitchen does not change, but you can see the addition of the walk-in cooler and walk-in freezer at this location, and then the adjustments to the storage room. That'll help get rid of the storage that's currently on the stage. Like there's a state with a bunch of canned goods, those kinds of things. Kind of get everything centralized so that it's easy to get to. So what we're looking at here is the cafe servery. So this is in front of the learning studio. I am not sure how close we can zoom in here and still stay on the page. All right, so basically we have two serving lines. This is more of a self-serve grab-and-go line on this side with some a merchandiser cabinet, so a refrigerated merchandiser, so it has like the refrigerated shelves with different food items that students can just grab and go. Next to that is kind of a self-serve food line as well with either hot or cold or both foods on it. And then you can see here in the center we have a checkout cashier station. If you go down to this other end, we've got a second serving line. This is intended for pre-made sandwiches, so if you've got like hamburger day, or chicken sandwiches, those kinds of things. They're on a sandwich slide is what it's called, like you would see in a fast food restaurant. Students can just grab the sandwich that they would like, but also warm or cold serving pans. So if this is a salad bar, you'd have all your salad bar fixing. Students go through, they grab their salad bar, they also continue on to the cashier station. Over here, we have a drop-off window for dirty trays and silverware, flatware, those kinds of things. Back here, we've got a dish machine, disposer, those kinds of things to help take care of cleaning up after everyone so that those things don't need to be taken all the way back to the high school. That can be done right here. As part of it, we have also a walk-in cooler. So this is for items that are going to be served in this cafe. So if it's a salad bar location, then the produce can be brought directly to this location. It can be prepped here, packaged, and served to students. It doesn't have to go back to the high school kitchen. So it saves time for staff taking things back and forth. A dry storage room here. You can see this is the prep food prep area. And then the walk-in cooler has doors on this side as well so that if staff is working the counter during lunch hour, they can turn around, open a door, grab the tray of lettuce, put it right immediately onto the serving line so there's no delay. So you can have really minimal staffing. You know, you have one person inside the cafe serving line and one person outside at the cashier station. It really economizes your staffing needs. You'll see we also have a sliding grill, like kind of like what you would see at a mall. It has the slats so you can still see through it, but pockets that it folds into, little doors that cover it. When you're done serving, you can close those gates up and then it's locked off from the public or students or anybody that you don't want to be going into that space.
It's really nice too, because that's gonna allow for light then in that room. Mm-hmm. Natural lighting is not, that's awesome. As opposed to the doors.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's just the mechanicals and electricals that go along with that. This is the commons servery. So you can see the elevator here and then all the student seating and the main commons area is off to the left of the page. So we have two serving lines at this servery as well. The first one we have that refrigerated merchandiser cabinet where students can grab and go, take things that are already packaged and prepared. There's also food pans here for either hot or cold. And then they go right to the cashier who'd be stationed right out here off front. Same thing for the other line. The merchandiser or milk, the lines where they receive the food, some storage units underneath so it's easy for grab and go or for your concessions folks to have lockable cabinets as well in that space. Behind here we've got the warming cabinets and those kinds of things that you would need to store the food while you're waiting to serve it to students. On the far right, we've got another dish machine. This is intended more for internal use. There's no window for students to bring trays to. We would imagine that would go to the other one. There's no point in having two dish lines for two drop-offs for students. You can easily put a mobile cart to collect trays and then just wheel them down to the other cafe. But to provide the flexibility for staff to be able to wash serving pans and those kinds of things, having the dish station here. At this location, we have a coiling door, which is similar. It's that grate, so you can still see what's going on back there, but you can close that and lock it. So that if you have an event in the gym and you want to serve concessions, you can use this serving area to serve the concessions, but you can also have equipment and supplies that are strictly for lunchtime food service locked away so that the public who's volunteering can't necessarily get to it. That helps the school out with their restrictions as far as the public health department, those kinds of things, and it just keeps things separated. So in the back here, we have a small walk-in cooler as well for any foods that might be prepared and served in this servery area. A food prep area, some mobile racks, and hot food storage, those kinds of things. You can see we've also got the same sliding aluminum gates with a pocket on this side and a pocket on this side. Those tuck away when you don't need them. You can slide those gates around when you don't want people to get in there or you're not using that. So that keeps it isolated, but it's still visible and contained. Are there any questions on food service?
So this area is also, as you mentioned, meant to be the concession stand area for the gym?
Yep.
So you have enough counter space for a popcorn machine, et cetera, in there?
There is supposed to be.
Okay. Just to make sure that we're able to continue with the same types of concessions that people are used to. Yeah, my popcorn.
If not, there will be at least room for things to be moved in carts.
Right.
That may have to be kept in other storage areas.
Okay.
But there will be room.
There should be enough space with the serving counters. You know, a lot of those, like the food, the hot and cold wells, you can just put a stainless steel sheet on top of it. It turns into just a regular counter. You can put your chips, your candy, all your stuff sitting on display so that you can use it for that function. The intention is to not build two spaces when one can serve both purposes.
Correct.
It is true. The popcorn machine probably won't be able to sit on the counter right there anymore, but it will be able to be moved onto the counter where we need to use it.
So it'll take a little bit more coordination to set up concessions, but we've allowed for space. We've planned for all the foods that they prepare, and they can use the same space to serve it.
Great.
And it's actually a far larger space than you would typically have for a concession stand. To be able to have two serving lines, you can use the same cashier stand, use kind of the same system.
And we've modified even to put in that wall that, or the door that closes so that the back storage part of the servery is not accessible when the concessions part is being used, or the front half.
I think I also want to note that there was discussion that rather than building a separate concession area, that we would wait for phase two, knowing that there could be a secondary gym at that time, and then that could be better located in vicinity to that. So also, I guess, for the public's knowledge too, we're not looking at this as a permanent, not that it maybe couldn't be, but we have had discussion that this would possibly just be a temporary setup for concessions until phase two.
Right, and the other part of that discussion was that when we did phase two, perhaps this concession stand would need to be adjacent to not only another gym, but also the auditorium too.
Yeah.
So the location at this time, we couldn't serve the best location for concessions at this time, nor did we have space for concessions at this time.
So we're planning for the present as well as the future.
Right, and sometimes the only way to know if something's going to work is to try it for 4 or 5 years. Mm-hmm. You know, give yourselves a year or two to get adjusted to it, then a year or two to tweak it and really settle in, and then determine, does this work for us or doesn't it?
Yeah, and it might change the offerings for concessions. Maybe they'll find that there are some things that they can now serve that they have the equipment for. So, you know, we'll see.
All right, the only other thing I brought was just the current floor plans as of this morning. I just thought, since this is the last board meeting before we go out to bid, if anybody wanted to ask any questions, or I can flip through them quickly. I know I didn't send this to you as a board exhibit ahead of time, but basically I have the first 6 sheets of floor plans, so the overall floor plans and then the enlarged plans of the 2 different wings on both floors. So if you'd like, I can flip through those. If you don't have any questions, that's fine too.
If you haven't made any major changes to them, I think they're etched in my mind the same way they were the last time you presented them to us.
No major changes.
We're good.
And I don't know if I mentioned this, a product rep for lockers came into our office, and I was asking them about creating mobile locker units. And the rep said, oh, you know, the last company I worked for, we did that for a place in Minneapolis. I'm like, was it the Fair Downtown School? He's like, it was. So we're able to get information right from the people that provided it the last time. So hallelujah. We know exactly what they put in now and how they did it. So that was exciting. Good news.
Great. Thank you.
All right. I think Pete from Estes has an update.
Thank you, Jean.
You're welcome. My shortest presentation ever.
It is. You know, I normally allow about an hour for you.
You might not be done.
But you mean that in the best possible way, right?
I do. Well, we are spending $18.8 million, and so I think an hour every month is minimal for that. But
thank you.
Well, good evening. Thanks for once again allowing us the opportunity to come before you and give you a quick update on what the project is looking like from a budget estimate standpoint. The information that we have on the screen here is certainly what was sent out last week and should be in the board packet that you received. So as we've done in the past, if I can navigate our let's see here. No. We'll do it this way. As we've done in the past, what I'd like to do is just hit on the executive summary and certainly entertain any questions you may have as we move through this. But essentially, where the project is at this point, with the 95% documents that Gina and her design team have pulled together, and what we know today based on the bid packages that were bid earlier, the project is at this state from the last estimate $138,455 under the previous estimate. So in total, the project sits at $102,905 under the 18.8 budget threshold that you set for the project. We still are carrying a design contingency. While we did reduce that, given some of the information that we saw in the documents, we are still carrying a design and bid contingency of $240,449. That is separate from a construction contingency that we are still carrying for the project. As you know, it's good practice until we identify all as many of the unknowns during construction to carry an amount of money that can be used for unforeseen conditions. So essentially the information that is before you tells us that with design and bid contingency and the $102,905 under budget, the project is sitting at about $343,354 under the 18.8. Now, as we have mentioned before, we would caution that the last stretch here, as Gene mentioned, before we go out for bid, we'd be conservative about the maintaining and preserving the design and bid contingency, only because as much as we try to forecast the bidding climate, we do know that some contractors are getting busier. Some have dropped off interest because they've won other work and therefore can't meet our schedule. So we just want to make sure that we stay conservative in the approach to what we may see in the bidding climate. We said that prior to the first round of bids going out. We were very fortunate that the contractors were very hungry and competitive on those bid packages, and we will do exactly what we did before, which is contact hundreds of subcontractors, suppliers, and prime contractors to make sure that they all have good knowledge of the project, that we can help them mitigate their risk in a way that they can then reflect lowering that risk in their competitive bid number. So, what I'd like to do, if there's no questions, just in the overview here, is just touch on, and I know this is hard for those of us out here to see, but on this next page, which will be page 2, is a listing of the items that contributed to the credit of the project, and also things that we have seen in the documents as the design has evolved. Now keep in mind, some of these will be adjusted again. For example, the environmental graphics that Gene showed you a few minutes ago, it seems like the design team has a much better handle on what those are. Well, now we know where they are, we know the quantities, we know the material, so now we can put a better price to them, a better estimate. What you see in here for that $49,000 is an allowance. Because we didn't want to go unrecognizing that there's a cost to them.
I like about $10,000.
Okay.
That would pay for a
partition.
And again, we'll hone in on that number. We'll make sure that we understand fully the extent of those graphics and refine that. So, as you can see at the very top of the page, those are the reflection of the actual bid dollars that we received on the five bid packages that went out prior to today. But all in all, the total cost variances from the last update is about $138,455. So again, we want to make sure we track some of the finite elements that are part of the design now. We want to make sure we reflect a cost to those. And as Gene mentioned, the mobile lockers, you know, that is one that we had talked about before, but we weren't sure if they landed as part of the project or as part of an alternate. You can see today it is reflected as part of the project, and we hope that with additional information, we can further refine the numbers that are reflected here. So all in all, we would look to be putting out the project a bid in about an additional 10 bid packages. And the thought being that we've been able to identify enough bidders in the paint, flooring, glass and glazing, in those specialties, that we can get them interested in the project and break that chunk of work out for them. Again, minimizing their risk, that's what they do, it's their craft. So if we set out a bid package that is right-sized for them, we hope to see that competitive bid environment once again.
That would also help bring together maybe some local folks.
That's
smaller,
correct.
Smaller portions, smaller chunks of it that they could tackle.
That is correct. In fact, there's been a couple of vendors in the community that have actually done some outreach to some of their network to get them interested and engaged on the project. A lot of times what we see is if the bid packages are too big, the smaller contractors have a hard time bonding the project size. So we're very aware of that, and we want to reflect that in how we've broken out the project.
Can I just, because the line item interior and security lighting adjustment of $216,000, why such a, what happened, what is that mask?
Yes, absolutely.
What happened there?
Yes. I'd say a couple of months ago, we were aware that there was some specialty lighting that could be included into the design of the project. And the specifics on that, Gene certainly could speak to, but in talking with and working with the electrical engineer, the types of lighting and fixtures that were being specified were of a slightly higher quality than what we would normally see in a middle school. So again, we wanted to reflect that. And this is certainly collaborating with the electrical engineer that knows the fixtures, knows the type, an upgrade in the control systems, that's the interior portion of the lighting. Now that happens not just in the learning areas, but also happens in the commons. It happens outside in the main entry, at the exterior balcony, if you will. There's fixtures there that we had not anticipated to be of the specialty that they are.
And just as long as to you too, it's interesting that we went that way, because I actually had a conversation with the superintendent who told me, beware of the fancy light fixtures. We need light, we want good quality light. We don't need fancy light fixtures. I want cosmetically good looking light fixtures. But I don't want something like I might see in the PIPAC Center in Cedar Falls, or something that I might see at the Ritz-Carlton in Chicago. Give me efficiency, don't give me decorative.
One of the other things too that I'm remembering is that we eliminated those clear story windows in that second floor, which probably increased our need for more lighting up there, I'm guessing.
In the
learning studio.
Oh, the circle on the top, I see.
Mm-hmm.
But does that have anything to do with that?
No, not really. No, we've been working with a lighting consultant to look at just certain areas in the building that we felt like were the most impactful. So the treehouse and the commons, in the gather spaces, in just a few key areas, really. Mm-hmm. And I think we've been working with him, Pete, probably since you've done this estimate as well, to reduce some stuff. So, you know, the numbers that we get from our lighting designer, when we say create something magical, this is our intent for the space, you know, we start out up here and then we whittle it down. So what I think where we've come to and worked with KCL is, this is our design intent. This is a fixture we were thinking of. Is there something that you know of that is a more affordable option that gives us the same quality of light? And there are some specialty things that we wouldn't typically put in a middle school, especially at the treehouse. We're providing to be able for students to use an iPad in that space and control the color of light in it. You know, and a few special things, but not an excessive amount. I'd be happy to put together kind of a PDF that shows kind of what the plans are, mm-hmm. and kind of what those areas are, so you get an idea of what you're getting.
It's just that, yeah, that would probably mm-hmm. be.
But you're right, yes, we're not doing big fancy pictures.
And it comes down to, we are trying to be keepers of our community's money, and mm-hmm. we want it to be nice, we want it to be beautiful, but we know there's a fine line between, we probably didn't need to go quite that far.
Right, and I think when you look at what we're proposing for the design, you'd be like, oh, that makes sense. But I'll send that to you, that way you okay. know it makes sense. Before the bids come in and you have a chance to weigh in on that, absolutely.
Thank you. Thanks, Jean. Yeah, and again, keep in mind that this is based on the 95% documents from late May. So I know Jean and her team have been working very diligently to identify these things, look for cost savings opportunities, and we'll certainly reflect that as we move forward. Mm-hmm. But again, we don't want to not recognize that what's in those documents is what we have to advocate on your behalf to be on paper. So.
And just for point of clarification again, how far, when you put a document together like this, how far behind their work are you once we see this? Isn't it a 3 to 4 week time frame?
It generally it is. It varies, and we know that Jean and her team recently put a 99% set together. So we were able to take a look at that and confirm some of the assumptions we had made. So while our budget estimate update indicates May 22nd was the documents we used, some of the information in here does reflect additional collaboration with Jean, maybe some additional ideas that have come up for reductions. And certainly, while we generally see about a three-week lapse, we're trying to stay more ahead of that here. Yeah.
Well, and once bids come in next month, then we will be much closer to a target other than change orders, because, sorry, we all know that there's going to be change orders in the project.
No.
Why do we know that?
I have yet to remodel my office that on day one a change order didn't come in.
Except our change orders are quite pricey. I think that's a lot of the reason. Gene and Pete are going to such great extent.
Sometimes change orders are good and they lower the cost. Right. So don't be scared of change orders. But that construction contingency is there for a reason. You know, and it's for things that are errors, omissions, unknown conditions, things that you just change your mind on.
Right.
You know, so you have control over the change orders, but there are going to be times when we ask you to consider something. You know, and sometimes it is because of an error or omission or an unforeseen condition, and, you know, that's the nature of construction.
Yeah, there will be change orders. Hopefully they all balance out or go lower than our projection.
That's correct. And again, working on your behalf, advocating for you, we'll challenge those change order discussions that are not in favor of the project. that's part of our responsibility.
Before you bring it to us for consideration?
Absolutely. In fact, as Gene mentioned, change orders can also help your project. So as an example, we know that when we do our pre-construction, or I'm sorry, our pre-award interviews with the apparent low bidders, one of the things we ask them for is cost savings ideas. And a lot of time these guys, since they do this every day, they have some ideas that perhaps we hadn't considered yet. However, if they do not meet the quality expectation, that's essentially where they may go away. We'll get with Gina and the team and ask her if that meets their quality requirement. And if it does not, then it goes away. However, if it is a viable idea, the bid amount is the bid amount. But then if you accept their idea to save money, you issue a change order to credit the project. So it's not entirely a bad thing. And then on the on page three is the alternate bid items as we've discussed them in the past. I believe the only there's a couple of other items that may find their way to the page the next time, one of which is potentially a scoreboard, which I think we were waiting on some information, and possibly some additional rolling shades. As the design has evolved, there's maybe some more consideration that's being given to those. So again, we just want to caution that we will update this as we move forward. So let's talk about some key dates. As we move along, this is one where we're looking to work with Gina and her team to make sure that the documents are of complete, have all the information that's necessary, and thereby ensuring that the documents go out in a fashion that again mitigates risk to the bidders. The more information they have, the less risk they have to represent their bid number. So the timeline that we've reflected here, with construction documents complete, essentially today or tomorrow, advertising the project for bid, we've identified the 23rd. Certainly these dates could slide within a couple of days. Issue the documents for bid on the 29th. Give the bidders an additional week, as we talked it through with the team, is probably a good idea for a project of this size. And then considering that the 4th of July happens to fall right as soon as the documents get out of the gate. So we can expect that some of the contractors, if not most, probably would not look at the drawings until after the 4th of July. It's unfortunate, but we see that happen a lot. So you can see that the bidding period we're looking at between June 29th and July 28th. Pre-bid meeting, July 14th. Bids due July 28th. We would conduct our pre-award interviews on August 3rd and 4th. And make a recommendation to award contracts on the 6th of August. At least that's when we would send the information, and then have a board meeting. I believe it's regularly scheduled for the 10th. So at that time we would come before you and hopefully answer any outstanding questions before you enter into a contract. So everything going in favor of the project, we would see a notice to proceed and send out notice to proceed in contracts between the 11th and the 14th of August. So continuing down that page, mobilization. I think you're starting to see some equipment showing up here on site. I know there's been several people out looking at the site, looking at the conditions. You'll see that some trees will probably start to do other than what they're doing now, either tomorrow or Wednesday. So we want to make sure that we've got a break in the weather and we can get some of these things happening. Now, despite the the scraper that's out there. They'll make some adjustment regarding, is it too wet to get the heavy equipment out there? But nevertheless, the trees have to be removed of their location. So that's the first activity that you'll see starting within the next couple of days. And you'll see Scott on and off here. You'll see Mike. In fact, he's staying here. He's not getting in the car and going home with me. So he'll be here tomorrow. I'm kidding. We drove separate. But with that, we still look to, despite the fact that we've added some days to the design team and also to the bidders, we still anticipate that we're going to do everything possible to keep the initial schedule. So, does anybody have any questions?
So we're looking at extending the bid time. So when would bids be due?
Yes, bids would be due the 28th of July.
And you're planning on opening them when?
That is the day, yes,
sir. That would be the day?
Yes, sir.
At 2 o'clock?
Yes. Yeah, and it would be a very similar drill to what we did several weeks ago. Certainly, you could be at the table in front and opening the bids or reading off numbers or however much involvement you would like to have.
Press will be there.
Okay, perfect. Great.
Middle school cafeteria.
Yes.
For the public.
Yes, middle school cafeteria, yes.
Any other questions or comments by board members? So we're not planning on taking action on that item. Thank you very much.
Very good. Thank you.
We look forward to seeing the work actually beginning.
Absolutely. Yes. And we'll keep you apprised of things that are happening out there. In fact, Scott and I are meeting tomorrow to talk briefly about how we want to do reporting in between board meetings. And perhaps we'll engage Jerry Mitchell to weigh in on his engagement and how often he would like updated. So more to come.
Thank you.
Right, thank you.
Thank you.
Moving on to agenda item 8, resolution for conveyance of property. Do you want to do this or Terry?
Terry.
We'll let Terry O'Brien talk about the conveyance of property.
We advertised the white building and received 5 bids. The 2 highest bids were actually very close, very, very competitive. But the high bid was from Jeremy Stewart for $3,001.50. Because that is under $5,000, we don't need a public hearing in order to sell it or that. We can just approve this resolution to convey the property over to him. He'll have until the end of August, if not sooner, to have the building removed. So.
And you did talk to him after you opened the bids, I understand, and everything
yeah.
is fine and understandable on their part to remove it by that deadline?
Actually, Jerry talked to him, and
okay.
He's understanding that that's what we need, and Jerry feels comfortable that he will be able to meet that schedule.
Any questions about this resolution for conveyance of property and the bidding? If not, do we have a motion?
I'll make a motion to approve the resolution for conveyance of property.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to approve the resolution for conveyance of property. Any other discussion? Hearing none, we'll ask for roll call vote, please.
Frisbee?
Yes.
Maycumber?
Yes.
Wintering?
Yes.
Walker?
Yes.
Dyke?
Yes. Motion carried 5-0. Agenda item 9, bus barn update. This would be you, Dr.
This
Cox.
Would be me.
Okay.
So, Director of Buildings and Grounds, Jerry Mitchell, 1-2. Planning and zoning, requesting several waivers, talked about that at the last board meeting. When it got to the meeting on the June 10th, the waiver requests were, just met with a lot of questions from city attorney and city officials. Jerry and Terry McCarthy had some questions for them about, you know, did all of the portions on the north need to be concrete, or could that as well remain gravel? There's been an issue with public versus private. The city engineer keeps referring to the public space, but it's city property, and so it isn't for public parking, it's for our employees. And so that issue aside, as they talked, there was a concern raised from the school that can we make some changes? And because of that, the recommendation was for the city council not to act upon it because the request was changing, but to come back to planning and zoning with whatever the revised request is. We have since had discussions here at the district office about how to accomplish this without having to go through the waiver process for the whole project. Continuing with the waiver on the storm sewer, which will go straight to the city council, it doesn't go to planning and zoning. Planning and zoning has already granted a waiver, or has given their initial approval for the west side, the backside of the bus barn project. So we've got a plan in place that over the next 2 years of buildings and grounds projects, that will just funnel the cost that it's going to take to do the concrete into the 16-17 school year, because we're not going to start until the spring anyway at this point. So really, by the time we would get to paving, it'll be beyond July 1st. We can plan for that accordingly as part of our summer projects for 16-17, knowing that if we need to make $80,000 worth of concrete, then we just reduce what we might have done in 17-18 by probably $30,000 is our guess. So that really is the intent of how we will move forward, is to continue with the project, going to bid at some point over the winter, start in the spring, finish it hopefully by August of 2016, with the request for the backside to remain gravel until we're prepared to put it to concrete or asphalt, or perhaps that just remains gravel because that's just where the buses are going to be parked anyway, and go to the city council with the request for the storm sewer, which we still need that waiver in order to move forward with the project. So that really is the next step.
Is the storm sewer, you refer to it as a waiver, is it a waiver, or we're asking the city to
The waiver that we're asking for is, we don't want to extend it from Pfeiffer to Wright. We're asking that the city take care of
the cost of extending it
through that alley so that we can connect at Wright Avenue. Correct.
Did you want to say anything about our meeting last Friday? Or
well,
you want me to?
Don't go either way. You know, Scott, you and I had met with Dr. Cox and Terry
as the finance committee
to discuss this and try to understand how we might be able to budget and pay for this additional cost. And I think that, you know, as you've outlined this, Dr. Cox, it's a good plan. It's a good way to achieve what the city's asking us for if we can't get the waiver.
Basically, what our recommendation or discussion was, because I haven't had a chance to talk to Jason with buildings and grounds, you know, with the initial request for waiver of the concrete or blacktop on the east side of the bus barn, we were still planning on doing that by 2020, I believe,
right,
is what
yes.
we had said. Well, in order to accomplish that, we would need to set aside money every year from our budget to come up to that dollar.
I had suggested a 4-year time frame just to give us a cushion,
right,
knowing that we would do it as quickly as we could.
And upon our discussions Friday morning in the finance committee meeting with Terry, rather than set aside money to do the project in the future, we have enough cash to do the 80,000 approximately of work up front, and we will set aside then money to pay back that 80 to 90,000 rather than setting money aside to do the project. We'll pay back the cash that we have sitting in the bank because we need that cash for future loans and other projects. Mm-hmm. You're doing the same thing, you're just spending it up front at a different time frame.
But I don't think we'll need to do that because we can already plan. The Washington paving project has come in under budget. Moving the white building is a cost that we'd already built in. Moving the white building, the current house for technology and transportation, okay, those things we've come in under budget.
So you think we'll still be fine?
And by the timeline, moving back to where we won't even be done until we're into the 16-17 school year, fiscal year, all of those things are working in our favor that we'll be able to pull this off if the storm sewer
if the
extension
storm sewer
comes through.
Extension comes through with the city council.
And with the west side waiver to leave that as gravel on the backside of the new bus barn.
Jim, does that make sense to you? Are you, does that?
It's interesting.
This look pretty
close. Some way, somehow, you gotta pay for it one time or whether you do it now or later. Mm-hmm. That's what bothers me is paying for it.
Mm-hmm. Well.
So let me just walk that.
I mean, you got money in the bank, but.
No. Let me walk through the first scenario that
okay.
I talked about. So. We're not going to be able to get it done in this fiscal year.
The current
right.
fiscal year.
The one that will start next week. So it's going to extend into the 16-17. Mm-hmm. So there's that portion of it. We already had set aside $50,000 to move the white building. It's not going to cost us $50,000. So we've got some savings there that can be applied toward.
That?
Because Jerry already has the anticipated cost on what it's going to be to do that. The sale of the white building or moving that, we had a cost figured in as to what we anticipated, and now we're not going to have to use up all of that cost either.
Okay.
So there's some things that we have saved money in the Washington paving project. There's a third one. Okay. So it isn't that we're having to take a whole bunch of money from the future and not do something. We've already said here was the budget for this upcoming school year or fiscal year, and we're not going to have to spend all of that already based on the bids that have come in. So that's money that could be applied toward this. That's why I say that as long as we get the waiver or the city's agreement to put the storm sewer from Pfeiffer to Wright, and as long as the backside can remain gravel, which planning and zoning had given the consent for, that those two things and the factors of where we're saving some dollars all work in our favor to still get this done by the 16-17 fiscal year.
What's the feeling of the city doing that?
Doing the storm sewer? I don't know because we haven't gone to them to ask that yet.
It's a city council decision.
That one doesn't go to planning and zoning.
I just wondered.
I would certainly think that they would look at it favorably.
I would hope so.
But they're going to have to budget that into their numbers for next year as well.
So that's probably some benefit to them than us to stepping back and giving ourselves basically another year. This project is taking on another 12 months for all concerned.
Right.
And this, you know, the Washington paving project is a good example of, you know, where the concern has been voiced of, you know, we're robbing money to pay for this that would go somewhere else. That's a $80,000 project that's a one-time project. You know, we're not doing that every year. So next year, what's our $80,000 project? The next year, what's the $80,000? There's not gonna be an $80,000 project every year. I could think of no specific citations of neglect in our district that would be of higher priority than the bus barn, you know. First of all, I mean, that's obviously been an item of neglect for decades, and that should be considered a very high priority. Being creative and spreading this over into a second fiscal year is, you know, we could, as long as that payment or final payment of whatever the concrete is or whatever it is after the 1st of July the following year is, you know, an appropriate use of that budgeting of that money. So that makes sense to me, and I support that usage or that structure of getting it done.
Well, if we remember, Jim, I know you, because we brought it out to your office at one time, that great big report they had on all the things that needed to be repaired in all the buildings.
Mm-hmm.
If you remember, it was not too long ago, Jerry came to tell us that's almost complete.
Yeah.
So that huge chunk of money, I remember we added it up that time, it was substantial. And those main things that needed to be done now, that were things that had been neglected and lacked, it wouldn't be there on a normal yearly maintenance schedule, are rapidly coming to a conclusion.
Nearly complete.
Yeah, nearly complete. So there is some light at the end of the tunnel, I think, for us as far as this. And we may be able to probably not rejoice, but know that there's going to be a little bit of comfort in knowing we've taken care of all those things that were neglected now. So now we're just going to be looking at needs in the future and some maintenance items as opposed to major repair items.
Of course, he prioritized the ones that he wanted to get done. I'm sure we got them done, but there's more coming every year. I mean, there's going to be more coming.
And a good example.
Just figure on that, no matter what it's going to be.
And a good example of that is that, you know, Jerry has established a 6-year plan on the roofs? That, you know, he's budgeted that. He's established a plan in place to make sure that each roof is on a 6-year plan, which is, you know, very responsible. So I can't say strongly enough how good a job Jerry's done in making sure that we're on solid ground with this stuff. And,
okay.
And you know, I you know, next time around committee assignments, I would certainly be willing to flip-flop with you, because the experience of working with Jerry in the buildings and grounds meetings is very comforting. And gives me a lot of confidence in the direction that we go with that stuff, because he's just right on the ball and sharp with all that. So
we talked about some of that in our finance committee meeting, mm-hmm. as well, about the long-term projects that Jerry might have, and while that list continues to grow, because, you know, we will always have some new projects that we'll be working on. He's just done a great job, and, you know, they're just won't be those huge expensive projects like we've had in the past 2 years.
Yeah.
So I think it's great to be able to, I'm so hopeful to get this thing done, because we've talked, the boards before us, as you remember, Scott, too, have been talking about this for
decades.
22
years ago, yeah.
And I would think it would be very important to the city as well to try and see that we improve the condition of that building for the city as well.
Ugly. It's. I drove around the backside the other day. I always drive down Clark. I drove on the Pfeiffer the other day around that way. And, yeah, you do tend to put it out of your mind because it's such an eyesore. So it will be nice for us to attend to that in the future.
I'm going to just do one point of clarification. When you brought up that you said we had taken documents out to Jim's office.
Before we were elected.
For point of clarification, that was between the time we were elected and the time we were sworn in,
mm-hmm.
so that we were not obligated under open meetings law regulations. We have not done so since. You said we, and I was involved in that we. But it was when we were not obligated under not having more than two of us at a time. So, anything else on the bus barn? We'll move on to agenda item 10, Washington Paving Project. Who's taking that with the administration? Mrs. O'Brien.
Went out to bid. Terry McCarthy has been working, SCHEAD has been working on it. They put together the plans, and we went out to bid. There were just two bids received. However, the low bid was under our estimate. So Terry was feeling pretty good about that. Because it's under, we had budgeted $90,000 for the project, and the bid with the alternates is $79,277.60, which is still under our budget. And as you spoke about being under budget on different projects, that would free up for other things. So we are recommending that the board approve the base bid of $62,883.92, alternate A, $11,686.70, and alternate B, $4,706.98. And then authorize the administration to negotiate the contract and the board president to sign the contract on the board's behalf. I know Jerry wants to get this project moving, and with the space between board meetings, if we were to wait for a board meeting to then approve it, it would significantly slow down work. So.
Is he doing some work up there now?
I don't know that.
Who's he?
DeBost. His dump trucks are running around back in there. The last two or three days, I've seen his dump trucks in there.
At Washington?
Yep. I just wondered if he had some other project he was doing, because if we haven't passed this one yet, he shouldn't be working on this one yet.
This is right out front. You'd see if he was working on this.
No, he was. He was hauling some stuff up from behind there. I seen him twice. He was loaded. Once I see him going back in there, so empty.
Could be the walk-in cooler project.
Yeah, I don't know.
Oh, yeah,
yeah,
tear that.
Yeah, he did
tearing that out.
It could be that
pouring concrete there.
Redoing the walk-in coolers in the kitchen.
We appreciate his bid. I'll make a motion that we approve the Washington paving project as presented.
Is there a second?
I'll second that.
It's been moved and seconded to approve the Washington paving project as recommended by the administration. Any other discussion? Hearing none, we'll have roll call vote, please.
Maycumber?
Yes.
Wintering?
Yes.
Walker?
Yes.
Grisby?
Yes.
Dyke?
Yes. Motion carried 5-0. Agenda item 11, district goals for 2015-16.
So the faculty have looked at these, sent them on to the School Improvement Advisory Committee, who is sending them on to the school board for approval, and they read as follows. The Charles City Community School District will increase the percentage of full academic year students in grades 4 through 11 who are proficient from the 2014-15 school year to the 2015-16 school year as measured by the NPR of the Iowa assessments in the area of reading. There's a second goal for math and a third one for science, all with the same language. And administration recommends that the board adopt the aforementioned goals for the 2015-16 school year.
Motion to approve the district goals for 2015-2016 school year.
Is there a second?
I'll second that.
It's been moved and seconded to approve the district goals for 2015-16 as presented. Any discussion? Hearing none, we'll have roll call vote, please.
Wintering?
Yes.
Walker?
Yes.
Grisby?
Yes.
Maycumber?
Yes.
Dyke?
Yes. Motion carries 5-0. Agenda item 12, reclassification of Carey Lane High School. This would be Dr. Cox again.
Yes. Alternative high schools in the state of Iowa must meet all of the same requirements as traditional high schools. So they have to meet all the requirements of Chapter 12 of the Iowa Administrative Code 281. They must have their own policies and rules. They have to have their own staff, their own resources. They have to have highly qualified teachers for all subject areas, meaning you have to have a math teacher for math, a science teacher for science, etc. They have to meet the offer and teach requirement in all subject areas. And there's a link that I provided you. It's on the agenda. The public can click on that as well to see what all the requirements are. Carey Lane High School this year served approximately 20 students. Typically it serves about 30. We've had two teachers there, and they are not certified in every subject area. We don't offer and teach all of the subjects that are required in Chapter 12, so we don't meet any of the first portion that I just talked about. So if an alternative school does not meet Chapter 12 requirements, then they have to be classified as an alternative program instead. Kerry Lane doesn't meet the requirements. There's no financial way that we're going to staff that as a second high school. So the recommendation is that you rename it the Kerry Lane program. And if there's a different name that Mr. Betts and the students come up with in the fall, we can go through another change at that point. But effective with the 2015-16 school year, Kerry Lane becomes a program and is no longer listed as a high school.
What does this mean to the program other than just the name change?
It means, the requirements for a Charles City diploma will apply to all students, so there won't be a Kerry Lane set of requirements and a Charles City. The program will still exist. Kids will go back and forth like they have to take courses that they want at the high school, mm-hmm. and then the rest of the day at Kerry Lane. But for all intents and purposes, we're going to just have a Charles City diploma and requirements for all of our students.
And we can still keep those kids down at...
They can still be
still
served
a,
in
a, still certainly. At the same location.
Certainly.
And then when it comes time for graduation, does that change their graduation?
You know, if they want to still have their own graduation ceremony, they can do it. The diploma is going to read Charles City High School rather than Kerry Lane. And that's something that Don and I have had some initial talks about. Okay.
What's the age group qualification for the Kerry Lane?
Currently, it's juniors and seniors.
Okay.
It's been a very successful program, even though it historically has not met these, and you foresee that to be continue, obviously.
Right. There's been a renewed effort at the state level to really push that if alternative schools across the state don't meet all of Chapter 12, then they must be reclassified, or they have to be staffed differently to meet Chapter 12. So we're not the only district facing this. In fact, when I went down to visit with Mr. Betts, he said, I wondered at what point you'd be coming to see me, because they've talked about this all year long at their meetings.
I remember, and I remember when this came up on our agenda probably a year ago, or I don't know when it was, that the requirements for alternative schools, I thought, that sounds like Kerry Lane's not going to fly. But, you know, I'm glad to hear that we can still maintain the integrity of the program for those kids. And, you know, we're in the business of handing out diplomas to as many graduates as we can each year. And those kids really, you know, need the program that works best for them. It sounds as though that Kerry Lane program has really been evolving to this past year. So that kind of fits with, you know, where this may be heading as well.
Do we have any students that fall by the wayside before they get old enough to qualify to go to Kerry Lane? I mean, like in the 9th, 10th grade, do we have, how many students do we lose a year? Do you have any ideas? I mean,
it's a small number, and that's why when you asked the question, I said currently it serves juniors and seniors. That's another area that is being explored further.
I mean, would there be some kids that we wouldn't lose totally if they could get them in there at 10th grade or
yes.
9th grade or
yes.
whatever?
Oh, that's great. Well, and it sounds like with the inclusion of Smart Lunch and some of the components there for students to be able to do some remedial work and Josh Dean's...
transitioning back to Charles City
High School
to really...
direct those kids where they need
to serve kids in the existing high school, or at Charles City High School, and then to identify and work with students who may profit from a Kerry Lane experience as well.
Sounds good.
Mm-hmm. And those kids that are enrolled in Kerry Lane, are they, we're getting state aid?
Yes.
On them, mm-hmm. as just regular students?
Yep.
Okay. So the ones we lose are actually, we're losing 4, 5, or 6. If we had a place that we could handle them at a younger age, or you know, before they get the seniors or
correct.
Juniors, would be money in our pocket, so to speak, if it didn't cost more to do it than they were receiving.
Correct.
Okay.
Are the Kerry Lane students regularly weighted, or are they extra weighted for
the state formula?
Yeah, there's an extra weighting.
There's an extra weighting attributed to
at
the
risk.
Alternative school program.
No, at risk.
Right.
So we get more from the state for those students per student than we get for regular students.
But we don't have to leave us before.
Correct.
Their junior year.
Mm-hmm. If we don't have to have certified teachers, could we open it up to younger kids?
You're asking a lot of good questions, and really this is about the the identification of Kerry Lane as a program instead of a high school.
Okay.
So I don't want to stray too far off topic, but yeah, you're hitting on a lot of areas that
also I just wanted to
I've asked questions and we're working on. Yeah.
Okay.
Do you need a motion?
Yes.
Okay. I move to reclassify Kerry Lane High School as a program.
I'll second.
It's been moved and seconded to reclassify Kerry Lane High School as Kerry Lane program. Any other discussion? Roll call vote, please.
Walker?
Yes.
Frisbee?
Yes.
Meacumber?
Yes.
Wintering?
Yes.
Dyke?
Yes. Motion carried 5-0. Agenda item 13, confidential secretaries and handbook. You want to handle this?
Sure.
Or the negotiations?
Negotiations committee is recommending a 3.63 package increase for the confidential secretaries and no change in their handbook.
Is there a motion?
I move to approve the confidential secretary and handbook with the no changes to the handbook, the increase of 3.63% in their package.
I'll second.
It's been moved and seconded to approve the package increase of 3.63% to the confidential secretaries and no changes in their handbook. Any additional comments or questions from the board?
The percentage of 3.63%, does that percentage align with something else?
It aligns with the support staff bargaining unit increase that you approved previously.
Okay. So it's just basically follow through across the board is what's been done here?
Yes.
Okay.
Any other questions or comments? Hearing none, we'll have roll call vote, please.
Walker?
Yes.
Frisbee?
Yes.
Meacumber?
Yes.
Wintering?
Yes.
Dyke?
Yes. Motion carried 5-0. Agenda item 14, non-union hourly positions.
We have some non-union hourly positions that the negotiations committee is recommending a rate increase of 43 cents per hour, and those would include the homeschool assistance program, the intervention room, middle school students obtaining success, Title I involuntary preschool instructional assistance, and the transportation assistant. In addition, the committee supports a 91 cent per hour increase for the community mentoring director, as recommended by the mentoring board.
Is there a motion?
Motion to approve the 2015-16 non-union hourly rate increases as presented.
Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Been moved and seconded to approve the non-union hourly position rate increases for all of those positions as was presented. Any other discussions? Hearing none, we'll have roll call vote, please.
Frisbee?
Yes.
Meacumber?
Yes.
Wintering?
Yes.
Walker?
Yes.
Dyke?
Yes. Motion carried 5-0. Gen item 15, director contract and handbook.
The committee is recommending a 3.36% increase for the Director of Buildings and Grounds and Transportation, Business Manager and Technology Director, and wording changes to the vacation section of the Director Handbook. Directors who work fewer than 12 months will not accrue vacation. And then you'll act separately on the Food Service Director position.
Is there a motion?
Go ahead.
I'll make a motion to approve the director contract and handbook.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Been moved and seconded to approve the director contracts as presented with a 3.36% total package increase and the changes to the handbook.
Just to build on what Robin had asked earlier, that aligns with the
Teaching staff. Yes.
And that's historically how it's been.
Correct.
Any other comments or questions? Hearing none, we'll have roll call vote, please.
Maycumber?
Yes.
Wintering?
Yes.
Walker?
Yes.
Frisbee?
Yes.
Dyke?
Yes. Motion carried 5-0. Agenda item 16, food service director contract.
Negotiations committee recommends the 2015-16 salary for the food service director to be $41,400. The contract length will be 225 days with benefits outlined in the director handbook. The length of the contract and the salary for the position are comparable to the director of food service positions in Northeast Iowa Conference schools. Now, this is a change up until this point, or for the past 2 years anyway. It's been a part-time position, and this is to make it a full-time 10-and-a-half-month position.
So that means we'll have an opening in a kitchen manager?
Correct.
One of the things that we looked at and considered very strongly is the fact that this is, not only did she have this as a part-time job, but she had another part-time job as head cook. And in order to take the single job, it's going to be one heck of a cut in her pay, because it was, you know, substantial. And so we decided that what she'd been making as food service director before was, and what we're asking for her to do, and the expectations that the board has for her to handle, that in order to keep her, we're going to have to increase it more than just what she'd been making before as a, what do you want to call it, food service director. Because now she's going to be full-time, but we didn't allow for vacations, some other things. We did raise her salary, which is still a long ways from what she was making with both jobs.
But that's not our, I have concerns with that.
Raised it from what I had recommended to the committee.
This is a new position, and whether she chooses to take this position or not, it's not our responsibility to make the pay as to what she was able to work two jobs at before. Mm-hmm. It's our responsibility to set the job description we want at a reasonable wage we feel it is to pay for that.
That's right.
We understand it's going to be a lot of work for somebody. It's a lot of work for the gal in Decorah who makes $31,289 a year that we're going to model our food service program after. If I offer $38,000 and somebody around here doesn't take it, and maybe the gal in Decorah says, I can make $7,000 more if I go to Charles City, wouldn't that be a better choice? Would that be a better, or maybe not? I don't know. Have we taken and gotten too personal with deciding what our wages should be? This isn't a matter of how much I like this person and how, it isn't that. It's a matter of business. We're setting a new position.
You're right about that.
We're making, we're setting a new wage. Everything else is off the board.
But we also compared other school districts in the area, and we're not the high one, we're not the low one, but we're not the high one. Waverly was substantial.
Waverly was 55, and with our wage, we will be the second highest wage. Yeah.
The thing that we didn't have, and we don't know, is how many years of service were those food service managers at all of those wages. And you know, so we don't know if they've been there for 1 year, 10 years, 20 years. And that is a factor too. Maybe there's a lot of new food service managers in there. So.
I know the gal at Decorah is not. We know that for a fact.
Is not what?
Is not new. Because we talked to her and we interviewed her that day.
And I don't think that we made a decision because we know Dawn, because I never met Dawn in my life till that the other night. First time, that wasn't that I know her or knew of her or whatever else. I didn't know who she even was till she walked in the door that night and talked to us. So,
I think the recommendation of 38,000 is fair. When I look at these numbers of comparable districts, the average is $37,237. You're proposing a $5,000 above the average. $4,000 above the average wage. If we had a program that we didn't go out and look for better ways to do, to improve on, and we were just going to maintain that program, I would say let's go for it. But we're not. We're looking at completely revamping a program that isn't sufficient at this time. There has been time to bring it up to par. It is what it is. I can't justify taking that wage.
The thing that we were trying to balance without having all of the information is when you look at the salaries of the outlying school districts, not knowing if they're new food service directors at a 30, 34, whatever the salary ranges are as they're sprinkled around, not knowing the length of time that those directors have been there, and knowing the length of time that Dawn has been there, you know, for 25 years, as well as the amount of work and goals that we have given to her, and her willingness to, you know, already take strides to make changes before the school district ended.
But you don't feel you'd get that from someone else coming on board. And what if I were to call these districts up tomorrow and I were to find out that everybody on this list has 20 years experience? Would your feelings still be the same then?
Well,
would your choice
probably
still be?
Not. But it all depends upon the contract days. You know, they all have different contract days. And so, you know, what we're asking is 225 days. There is no vacation that we're paying. I think that was really the difference between what I would say, that if Dawn or anybody in this position had not been as willing to embrace the changes that we're asking of her, hadn't been forthright in already implementing some of them, you know, I would feel, yeah, let's go ahead and just keep it at 38 or 39.
In order to keep things moving along, I'm going to ask if you're ready for a motion.
I have one other question, I guess. Like we pointed out, that this recommendation puts us, you know, above, you know, there's, what is there, five, six example school districts, puts us above five of them. Is it fair to say our other director positions would fall in line in a similar manner, where we're at, where we would rank in that? Is that a fair comparison?
If you keep talking, I can pull it up. I can tell you from memory, technology director would be second in the conference out of seven. Business manager currently is second out of seven. I can't tell you where the buildings and grounds is without looking it up. Our high school principal, when we hired a year ago, was going to be like sixth out of seven.
I know we have a pretty strong tradition of, you know, obviously having looked at the teachers and the other other non-union positions of where we at, where we rank state on a statewide level, and not only in our conference,
yep,
but all of our other positions do rank quite highly.
Now we're waiting from this agenda item. Excuse me.
It was brought up several times during this last bunch of negotiations. And I think it's going to have to come to that. It's going to have to be on, and not on what everybody else is doing and what we did in the past. We're going to have to do it on what they earn, you know, how they do their job. And but we did hear some comment about Jerry last year when we gave him a little raise because he was doing exceedingly well. The rest of them looked at him and says, "Well, why did you get one?" You know, and so it made questions among the rest of the staff. And Jerry said it really wasn't worth it.
It was performance-based.
Performance-based, and that's what we're going to have to do on a lot of these salaries, is performance-based. I really think so.
Well,
I was incorrect. Technology ranks third out of seven. Director of Buildings and Grounds is second out of seven in the conference.
Well, the difficult thing, I think, about performance-based is that we don't have the direct knowledge of their performance. You know, we have the direct knowledge of how Dr. Cox is performing, and he is our only employee, but for me to judge fairly, you know, how, you know, Kara or Marsha are doing, you know, for performance and salaries, we can't do that. And we just don't have that information.
It would have to come as a recommendation from the one who evaluates them.
Yes.
And building on that, your recommendation for this position was lower than what's recommended by the committee, is that?
Yes. I believe it was 39.6.
The other thing with positions like this is we have to be aware of that the school is not its own entity. It's different when we talk about teachers because schools are in competition with teachers. But when it comes to food service people, janitorials, managers, things like that, there's other companies that these people work at in our community. So we need to not only be taking our wages into account, but also these other companies. What is a food service director at Comprehensive Systems making? What is a food service director making at the Chautauquas? Because those are people that would also be, or a busy restaurant, or a good restaurant over Mason City, those would be people that would also be in competition for these jobs that we need to look at their wages and balance them out, because if we offer a wage, we may be attracting, we don't need to just attract people from other schools. We're not looking at just shuffling these employees around between schools. These are general public outside people that can come for these positions.
So I'll ask again, are you ready for a motion?
Yes. I'll make a motion to accept the committee's recommendation on food service director wages.
I'll second it.
Any discussion? Just for point of clarification, I probably will vote no on this because I would rather go with the superintendent's recommendation of salary for this new position.
I think looking at the information we provided with our neighboring districts, it's in our best interest.
As this is being, quote unquote, it's technically a new full-time position. We're transitioning from a part-time position to a full-time position. So as in what we've talked about in previous meetings as to explain ourselves, so that there's no doubt as to why we voted the way we did, I'm just giving you a heads up.
And I tend to agree that.
Well, that too, so.
Well, go ahead.
You have to explain yourself, because we don't have to explain yourself when you vote yes, so why do you have to explain yourself when you vote no? I mean, it's nice that you did it, but you don't have to.
Because someone will
question. I'm not asking you to explain yourself when you vote yes, so.
There will be questions, either from this audience or from the audience watching on TV.
Okay.
Any other comments?
Question.
Roll call vote, please.
Wintering?
Yes.
Walker?
No.
Frisbee?
Yes.
Maycumber?
No.
Dyke?
No. Motion failed. 2 yes, 3 no. Do we have another motion?
How can you second the motion and then vote no?
You can second a motion or even make a motion and vote against it.
I guess.
Just to
so now
get
what
it
do you
out
want
of
do?
The way.
Aye.
Now we need another motion so that we can have a food service director as of July 1.
I move to approve the administration's recommended
what do they got
salary
they
for
got
the food service
for?
Director contract. I believe it's $39,600.
Yeah, that's correct.
I'll second that.
It's been moved and seconded to approve a food service director contract at $39,600 for the next fiscal year.
Well, for the record, I just want to tell you right now, I'm going to vote no.
We understand. Any other discussion? Hearing none, we'll ask for roll call vote, please.
Frisbee?
No.
Maycumber?
Yes.
Wintering?
No.
Walker?
Yes.
Dyke?
Yes. Motion carried, 3 yes, 2 no.
Fine.
Agenda item 17, non-administrative salaried personnel and handbook.
The negotiations committee recommends the following non-administrative salaried personnel increases and handbook changes. a package increase of 3.36% for the technology assistant, the Transition Alliance Program, or TAP coordinator, and the juvenile court liaison officer. Handbook change to include the addition of New Year's Eve Day to the list of holidays, and a title change for the information specialist. The new title will be Communications and Community Engagement, and that was selected to better reflect the nature of the position and to align it with similar positions across the state. Salary adjustment for the Communications and Community Engagement position from $47,500 to $55,000 to bring it closer to the market rate for similar positions. Also, the addition of paid break as designated by the district is set forth in the school calendar for teaching staff and students for spring break for that position.
Any questions? Is there a motion?
I move to approve the non-administrative salary personnel handbook as presented.
I'll second it.
Been moved and seconded to approve the non-administrative salaried personnel and handbook as presented. Any discussion? Hearing none, we'll have roll call vote, please.
Walker?
Yes.
Frisbee?
Yes.
Makeumer?
Yes.
Wintering?
Yes.
Dyke?
Yes. Motion carried 5-0. Agenda item 18, administrator contract and handbook.
The Negotiations Committee recommends the 2015-16 administrator package increase of 3.36% with no changes to the administrator handbook.
Any questions? Is there a motion?
Motion to approve the administrator contract and handbook.
I'll second.
It's been moved and seconded to approve the administrator contract with a total package increase of 3.36%. And no changes to the administrator handbook. Any discussion? Hearing none, we'll have roll call vote, please.
Walker?
Yes.
Frisbee?
Yes.
Makeumer?
Yes.
Wintering?
Yes.
Dyke?
Yes. Motion carried 5-0. Agenda item 19, consideration of consent agenda. Is there a motion?
I'll make a motion to approve the consent agenda as presented.
Is there a second?
Second.
Been moved and seconded to approve the consent agenda as published. Roll call vote, please.
Frisbee?
Yes.
Makeumer?
Yes.
Wintering?
Yes.
Walker?
Yes.
Dyke?
Yes. Motion carried 5-0. Agenda item 20, July meeting dates.
Reminder that I'm out of state on July 20th. With the changes in the bidding timeline that Estes has presented earlier this evening, there's a recommendation to have two board meetings in July, do one on the 13th, do one on the 27th. We have a few personnel items that we'll want to take care of as quickly as possible, so July 13th would be ideal for that. We have bills to pay, et cetera. And then if there are any additional items related to the building project, we can be dealing with those on the 27th. What are your thoughts on that?
Jim, will you be able to attend the meeting on the 13th of July?
I don't know, I have no idea. Probably, more than likely not.
What about by telephone?
Probably could.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Because yeah. Robin likely will be calling in as well.
Okay.
And we will intentionally keep it as short as possible.
That's fine.
Yeah. And then do the heavier things on the 27th.
Oh, okay.
If there are any bigger items, but anything that's not essential, we'll just do it at the second meeting. But we do want to take care of some personnel and bill paying.
Okay.
At least those two items on the 13th.
Well, it just depends because they talked. I met with my surgeon and they're gonna do something different this time around. That gonna have you up and walking the same day, so we'll find out.
And the 27th for sure, though. You'll be skipping rope by the 27th.
I hope so.
Okay.
Okay. So is there a motion?
I'll make a motion to approve the July meeting dates.
Of July 13th and
27th. As presented.
And not July 20th.
And not July 20th. Okay.
All together now?
Is there a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to change the July meetings, not have one on the 20th, but we will meet on the 13th and the 27th.
And for the record, those are both here. All summer meetings are in the high school library where it's air-conditioned. But in July, don't attempt to park in the north lot. It's going to be filled with construction equipment, so make sure to park at the main parking lot and come in those doors.
Ready for a roll call vote?
Acumber?
Yes.
Wintering?
Yes.
Walker?
Yes.
Grisby?
Yes.
Dyke?
Yes. Motion carried 5-0. Agenda item 21 is to adjourn to closed session as per Iowa Code 21.51A. Is there a motion?
Also move that we go to.
Is there a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to adjourn to closed session as per Iowa Code. The purpose will be to discuss the superintendent's evaluation. Roll call vote, please.
Wintering?
Yes.
Walker?
Yes.
Grisby?
Yes.
Maycumber?
Yes.
Dyke?
Yes. Motion carried 5-0. Just for note, Comet boys are ahead 3-2 after three innings. No, they're behind. Crestwood's ahead, sorry.
One other note, we will come back to open session to act upon the superintendent's contract, which is item number 22. And then to go through upcoming dates and then to adjourn. I would guess we'll be in closed session 30 minutes?
Probably.
Jeez.
And we'll take a
20 to 30 minutes.
You go into Google for
a short break before we actually go into closed session.
Yeah.
So in the meantime, we're going to recess.
Okay.